It is 30 minutes past 8. The Eco Store is a successful business, but not a traditional business. It was set up in 1993, and these days manufactures over 60 products. It turns over 30 million plus, is exported to Australia, the US, Hong Kong, Singapore, Taiwan, and Malaysia. It's a mixture of business and charity driven by a desire to save the planet. And Malcolm Rands is the man who came up with it all, and he is with us. Good morning.
Hey, Mike.
Have I got that right? Have I described that reasonably accurately?
Nice, very nice.
Oh, yeah. Good. So how did it start?
Well, it actually started because I used to work in not-for-profits and I just got completely fed up with the whole world. I mean, I'd spend 80% of my time trying to raise money and only 20% of my time doing what I wanted to do. And I had the worst boss in the world, a sort of committee of the local do-gooders who'd turn up, they didn't really want to be there, and that was your decision-making board. And I thought, there's got to be a better way. So I thought, if I could create a completely successful business, they could take on the world, make lots of money, then that would fund my not-for-profit.
And so how does that sit with people in your realm? Because there seems to be a group of people in your circle that don't actually like money or certainly don't like profit.
You're right. I mean, you're 100% right. My other background's the arts, and there's this thing about money, but I have got a very positive aspect to money, because to me, money is just energy. It's a way of, we create energy to do things, to get people to do things, to buy things. And who should have the energy? I mean, people doing good should have the energy. So I've got no problems. I'm not actually out to buy a super yacht. I'm out to raise money for charity. So I've got no
problem. So the more you make, the more other people benefit.
Exactly right.
Simple as that. I get a sense from reading your book is that you were a bit of a drifter. Is that right? You weren't quite sure what you were going to do. And somehow this sort of clicked.
You're right. You know, I mean, until I was about 30, I knew what I didn't want to do. It was more by chance. I started ending up working for the Auckland City Council and their recreation plan, and then I ended up north working for the Arts Council, and it kind of fell into place more than direction. It just sort of turned up, but I grabbed the opportunity and ran with it.
Did your parents give up on you? Did they see you as a hopeless case? I mean, you know, I want my kids to be full of direction. I want to know them where they're going and what they're going to do. And if I had you on my hands, I'd be thinking, for God's sake, get it together. Pick something to do. Find something to do.
It's not I wasn't doing things. It was just, if you look back, I mean, I was in a rock band when I was 16, and I was, you know, I kept myself busy.
Yeah.
It's just I wasn't sure what my big career was going to be, but I was always full of passion. I was charging around doing things, but none of them were kind of traditional. But then again, my parents weren't that traditional either.
Oh, okay. So they were okay with it. Knowing what you know now and having started and formed and developed a big business by anyone's standards, could you have done it with anything? Or did it have to be eco?
It had to be something I truly believed in. I mean, certain times in my life, I've found I've had great power to convince people to do what I want to do with me. I've always been part of big groups, but it's always got to be something I completely believe in that I've got great passion about, and then I can move mountains.
Okay. And what percentage do you think, or do you track, the people who buy Eco? See, now, I was telling you, we've got the rinse aid at home, and we got the soap. And my producer's got the lip balm. She swears by your lip balm. She thinks it's the greatest lip balm in the world. So what percentage of people who buy this stuff do so with your values in mind, or simply buy it because potentially it looks good on a shelf?
Well, actually, our big point of difference is our health proposition. There's a situation, it's come out with the United Nations, and more information is coming out all the time, that a lot of the household chemicals are not particularly good for your health.
Mm.
And so our biggest proposition is not to save the planet. That's, of course, very important, but we're paranoid about what ends up against your skin. And there's so many people around New Zealand, they've got rid of asthmas, they've got eczemas have gone, rashes have disappeared by just changing to our product. And that is hugely powerful. If you look at word of mouth, people saying, try this, it's worked for me. That's our number one marketing tool, is people saying, try it yourself.
Okay. But when I put the rinse aid into my machine last night, I, to be honest, got no idea what's in it. It's rinse aid and I'm washing my dishes. So should I think beyond that, or you don't care because I paid you the money anyway and it's going to go off to do something good?
I think you should care drastically about it. I mean, as I said, you know, we are unwittingly poisoning ourselves in the Western world. I mean, the information is coming out more and more all the time. I think you should be very, very careful, because there's so many things happening at the world. We don't know where it's coming from, particularly talking about hormonal problems. We're talking about allergy problems. I think you should care very, very, and particularly for your children.
What about the costs and hassles of keeping it clean? Is it still difficult to produce a product that's good, if you like, and doing it at a price people are prepared to pay for?
Not at all. It's, I mean, that's why success is so important to us, because the bigger you get the economies of scales, you know. So we're in over 1,000 supermarkets in Australia now, and just that scale is really helping us, because it's driving our costs down all the time and making us competitive. And if you look, we concentrate everything we do, and if you look at cost per use, we are no more expensive than any other brand in New Zealand.
Okay, so is that still a message you've got to put out there, or do people now understand that anyway?
Oh, completely. For some reason, if you look at Nico products, say, oh, I'd like to use that stuff, but it costs too much and it doesn't really work. That is history. That was maybe 20 years ago. Today, they work just as well, and they're very cost-effective.
So given that, how come your competitors, if you like, survive and prosper? How is it that we all haven't? I mean, if you've got the choice and I can buy clean and green and it costs no more and works, why are they still even in business?
Well, watch the space.
Do you think that's
watch
where
the space.
Do you think where it's going eventually?
Oh, definitely. In fact, my story is one day we can't call ourselves Eco Store because everyone's going to be eco, so we're going to have to call ourselves Store, because it's definitely where we're heading. And our big problem is if we're mainly a cleaner brand, and if you walk down the cleaner aisle in a supermarket, it's kind of like a grudge purchase, you know. You're not happy down that aisle. You're sort of, oh, my God, I have to buy this stuff. So it's very hard to get our messages across to enthuse people. But then again, as I say, our best advocates are other people using the products already.
See, I'm wondering also, let me put this idea to you, that I wonder if the green, I don't know if it's the green movement, but the broad concept of spending a lot of time and energy and money and saving the planet hasn't peaked post the GFC, when we suddenly had this massive change of mindset, and you can cite the carbon debate and all of that. Suddenly we got back to bare bones of feeding the family, holding our job, worrying where the money was, and all of that extra stuff, if you like, kind of took second place or back seat.
No, you're 100% correct that things slowed down hugely after that. And I think it was mainly because when people go into some sort of panic mode, they don't like any sort of change. They just sort of stick with what's tried and true. Mm. And I mean, to tell the truth, a lot of people will buy their cleaning products because their mum did, you know, and they don't want to change, you know. So it, to us, to make people change, it's a big problem for us, but we're niggling away. We're the only sector that is in growth in the cleaning sectors and supermarkets. Most of the products actually going down in dollar terms, and we're still rising. So trends on our side.
Where are you standing on our whole debate about the clean green image, 100% pure in this country and stuff like that? Is that important? Do you leverage off that?
Completely. That is so important to me. Like I say, why is a housekeeper in Asia buying EcoStore dishwashing liquids, you know?
It comes from New Zealand.
It comes from New Zealand. They've got this safe, this pure. They're actually buying a dream of something they're bringing into their house. Our image is so important. I mean, the thing I keep on saying to, like, if you go to the supermarket and you buy a sort of nice bottle of bubbly wine, you know, you can pay $15 to get a nice bottle. If you get that from a little place called Champagne, you put another zero on it. And
sure.
I reckon that is the potential we've got in New Zealand. Safe, pure from New Zealand. We can add value so much. And we've got a position any other country in the world would die to have, and we're blowing it.
So you argue it is damaged. We are damaging it.
Oh, completely damages. Because the worst thing you can do in business is overpromise and underdeliver. It's the worst thing you can do. And that's what we're starting to do.
So how are we doing that? How are we damaging it?
Well, what is happening is that the international media, they like a tall poppy to knock down in New Zealand. You know, we've been saying we're so good for so long. It's a great story, you know. You come along, you look at our rivers, you look at the statistics. We're heading in the wrong direction.
When you say that, see, I wonder, I mean, you're probably right to an extent, but then that's to believe, or to start at the beginning, to believe that somehow we were 100% pure, and we were never. And it's sort of unrealistic to expect we were. And, you know, so if you wander around a few rivers and find one dirty, somehow it's a scandal and a fraud. I mean, that was being unrealistic, wasn't it?
Yeah, but this is all very emotional stuff, isn't it? And we were clean and green, and it wasn't because Kiwis are such wonderful lookers after of the environment. It's just basically because we haven't got many people here, and we've got the cleanest wind and rain and the planet washing away our naughtiness every day. And we are clean and green, but it's not because we're great environmentalists.
We just happen to be lucky to be in the right part of the world and
exactly
a small
right.
island. So what do you have a global plan? I mean, I listed the countries you're in. Does it go beyond that eventually?
Oh, definitely. I truly believe that New Zealand needs more big brands, and I want EcoStore to be one. I want us to be a billion-dollar company.
Billion-dollar company.
Oh, definitely.
Good on you. And you still got the growth path to go from your 30 million now to get there?
Oh, why not? You've got to start somewhere. I think we're a startup. I really do.
Good on you. Lovely to see you. All the very best with the book.